Hi, it's Roseanne, and I'm here at Full Moon High Tide Studios, my studios, where I can say anything I want to say, and I can't get fired, which is great.
It's the way I do it from my house.
Yeah, you do a great podcast. What's it called?
I just do a podcast or a Periscope. It's The Real Hub Life is my account, and Still Breathing with Brenden, Dilley.
And your name is Brenden, Dilley.
Yeah, I'm an author.
Yeah. And you're a life coach as well, right?
Yeah, I am.
And you are a firm Republican, right?
Well, I don't know if I would call myself a Republican. I guess I would call myself a Trump Republican is more kind of where I
What's the difference?
I think it's a little bit more bold, a little more conscientious. I don't know that I necessarily identify with kind of the old branding of the Republican Party. I don't know that most people who are now residing within the party think of it that way. Yeah, the Trump Republicans. It's like get it done Republicans.
Don't you think that Trump destroyed both parties?
Yes.
He did, didn't he?
Yeah. What he did was he rebranded. And I think that's one of the most amazing things that we've seen is that the Democrat Party used to hold reign over the branding and optics, right? So for many years, if you cared about other people, you cared about other human beings, and you were concerned about their needs, you started to gravitate towards the Democrats because that was their branding. And I think now what's happened, thanks to Trump derangement syndrome, they're the party of violence. They're the party of intolerance. And now the Republicans are more towards the middle and look ultra-tolerant by contrast, you know, just like when we had Peter Thiel speak at the Republican National Convention, first openly gay man to speak at that convention, and he got a standing ovation. And so it's hard to... I think ignore the optics of that moment, and then you compare it with the Democrat National Convention when we had riots in the streets from Bernie Sanders supporters and Hillary supporters. So it's been an interesting 2 years.
Yeah, but I think Trump made the old Republican Party obsolete.
Yeah.
And smashed the Democrat Party. And how do you think he did that?
Being honest. Honesty is like back in vogue. I think that was the biggest thing. I think Americans are so tired of political correctness, and they're so worn out with having to watch everything they say or every joke that they laugh at. They feel weird even siding with things that they know, like they've been conditioned to not laugh at certain things or not observe certain things because it could be perceived some kind of way. And I think you can only live under that type of kind of oppression for so long before you finally are like, I know I'm not these things. I'm a good person. And it's okay for me to laugh at this stuff or say something dumb or do something dumb and then apologize. I think that's being a normal human being. And I think it's too fine of a line to try to toe that, you know, the political correct line.
So I don't identify as a Republican per se. Right. I just say I'm independent thinker and I'm in the middle where most of America is.
Right.
This one, they have some good ideas and they have some good ideas. But the thing I want is results.
Yep.
Right? We want results, not just talk,
yeah.
Not just gridlock where they blame the other party because they can't do nothing for people who need help,
yeah.
But actual results, which is why I like Trump, because jobs went up and you can't deny it.
Absolutely. Well, and that's the thing too, is that, you know, being a results Republican, I think is really, it's all about doing what needs to be done. It's one of the things I appreciate about President Trump is that he knows he's going to take arrows from the media and the public on a lot of the moves that he makes initially. And I think that shows it's a great sign of leadership when you're willing to do the unpopular thing, knowing that the end result's going to benefit everybody. And that's kind of what we're talking about right now is that, you know, smashing political correctness, but also simultaneously working in the backdrop to reinvigorate the economy and protect our soldiers overseas. One of the things I tell people that, you know, a lot of Americans aren't aware of is that if you ever see a Trump tweet going out that seems a little bit risky, one of the biggest tools that he's used over the last year and a half is that tweet, the Twitter sphere. And what he does is he sends out a deranged tweet or a really controversial tweet, and he tends to time those with military operations overseas. Now, the public doesn't understand this. The mainstream media is certainly not going to report it, but it's the truth. What it does is it gets everybody reporting and focusing on one area, and it keeps our troops safe abroad while they're running operations, and you never hear about the operations because of it.
But you said that that it's guaranteed 36 hours after the weird tweet that we see results that
yeah That's the window that I look at. Everything in the current climate is give it 36 hours because most of the time he's setting something up. And this is part of, I had written about this, which is one of the most effective methods I think he has used to highlight the sheer, insincerity and dishonesty of our mainstream media is I think that his administration deliberately, and maybe some people close to them, they send out information that's fake news, and then they know that fake news doesn't vet anything, and they just run with it. And then what he does is he lets it go out there for 48 hours, they blast him, and then he reports the real news later. And every time he's done this, every couple days since he got into office, it's wash, rinse, repeat, and it's further and further delegitimized the mainstream media, which is obvious by their ratings, which are in the tank.
Well, let's talk about my tweet. Do you get it?
I get it. I laughed. I get it. Because I'm a normal person, though. Like, I think in order for you to find that tweet offensive or racist, you have to project your own inherent racism onto it.
I think that, too.
I thought observational humor is observational humor. And I think that it's weird how they try to isolate. Like, you have to, in order for that tweet to be racist, you have to view it entirely through one prism, which is, okay, this is racist, and it's everything about it is racist, and you have to forget everything about all the context. You have to forget who sent it, you have to forget why they sent it, and you have to forget what both of these individuals look like, because you're not allowed to notice the observation either, because then it wouldn't be racist anymore, it'd just be an observation. And I think that's one of the more strange things.
Well, I didn't say she looked like.
Well, no, but I thought she did. I mean,
people are saying that, but it was a movie character.
I thought it was the haircut. I just looked at the haircut. I didn't go beyond that. I never.
I didn't have anything to do with that optic.
Right.
What I said was, what I intended in my tweet was to wake people up about Iran,
right.
The Iran deal, which is central to
right.
Everything that is being investigated today.
Right.
But they won't go there.
No.
And they don't report on Iran. They don't report on the Iran deal. They don't report on this. It's in a silent place. And I wanted people to go look it up.
Right.
And see where their money went.
Well, and that's part of it, too, is I think that they didn't give you credit for that level of thinking.
No. They never do.
Which is kind of garbage. I mean, that what they did was they took it completely at face value. Some of us who just glanced at it, I laughed and moved on with my life. I didn't think beyond those terms. Obviously, when your explanation came out, I was like, oh, that's a really good comparison, a great analogy and to educate people onto that subject. But on its face value, I just thought, yeah, they have a similar haircut. And that was where it stopped for me. It didn't go beyond that because I'm not racist. So I never even thought to think of it in any other terms than just as a joke.
Well, it's like, we propped up an immoral regime,
right,
with the Iran deal, a regime that throws gays off buildings and stones rape victims,
yep.
And also the money that the American taxpayers sent to those tippy-top mullahs,
right,
that are, the overlords, in that movie,
yeah.
They're the overlords of all the human beings who they seek to lock down.
Right.
And it's not working. Since Trump canceled the deal with Iran, the people are in the streets. They want freedom like every other people.
Absolutely.
And they don't report on that either. And when they call me for, because they just want to go, why did you say, all black people, blah, blah. And I'm like, why don't you report on Iran? I've asked all of them.
Right.
Why don't you report on the People's Revolution in Iran, the women in the streets taking off their hijab and, saying we don't want to be forced to do anything. If we choose to wear the religious identification of our particular religion, then we have that right.
Right.
But you can't force people.
Right.
And it's all about force and lockdown. And America's like that, too.
Yeah, well, I think that's part of it. Part of what is so bizarre about the reporting on that tweet and of Iran in general is that, again, they ask the public to suspend what you know about other topics. And so they try to get you to view everything through a vacuum, which is, okay, Iran, like literally right now, the mainstream media is trying to portray Iran in a positive light simply because that's the resistance to President Trump right now.
Right.
And it's the weirdest thing because the left simultaneously is advocating for gay rights, transgender rights, women's rights, while simultaneously in the same broadcasts advocating for places like Iran that are extremely oppressive under the current regime. And I think a lot of Americans, if you sit in front of that for more than a few minutes, you start to realize the hypocrisy of the reporting. You realize this is just manipulation.
Or you just go to sleep and swallow it.
Or you go to sleep. Well, and here's one of the things I had mentioned to people, that the reason that President Trump went economy first on this, when people are suffering and they're struggling and they're broke and they are just trying to pay their bills, nothing else matters.
Right.
And so you can do the CNN thing like we were just discussing, and you can indoctrinate people because you only have so much you can care about. Right. And so, like, if I'm sitting there and I got to wake up at 3 a.m. to get ready for my job, I can't invest into researching this information because I'm broke. I don't care. It's beyond my reach. But what happened is when President Trump starts juicing up the economy and you're making more money and you have more time on your hands, all of a sudden the things that you used to just take at face value from the mainstream media, you have the ability to explore those things a little bit further.
Well, you could just go on Google. But,
right.
You know, when I set out the tweet, Google that day said that the number one Google search was for Valerie Jarrett.
That's awesome.
Which I think people should know.
It's perfect. She's back
author,
in the news.
She's the author of the Iran deal.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, yesterday in the news it said Peter Stroke. Did you read that? Where his father was an Iranian operative, and he was part of Iran.
He was raised there.
Right.
He went to an Iranian-American school until 79 when it closed down, and then he finished out his schooling in Saudi Arabia. His father, from what we can tell, appears to have ties to both the FBI and the CIA. I mean, and also his father has ties to John Brennan. And John Brennan's ties to the Middle East and Iran. So,
You think it was just a money laundering scheme to put the public money into private hands, and they laundered it through Iran?
Yeah, I think a lot of this boils down to money.
So it's nothing different than Bush did.
No.
It's been going on for a long, long time, taking the public's money and putting it in private pockets.
That's exactly it.
Isn't
and that's
it?
Why that's why they hate Trump, because he's ruining the party for everybody who's corrupt. He's ruining it indiscriminately too. He doesn't care who you are, what business model you're subscribing to. Doesn't care if you're a German automaker. He doesn't care if you're a pharmaceutical drug maker. He's everyone's going to toe the line one way or the other. It's a matter of time. And that's the other thing, is it's not a matter of will Trump win or will he succeed. It's a matter of when. That's all it is. And he has the patience to sit and wait things out. And I think right now, as we're watching this right now, like with your tweet with Valerie Jarrett was perfect, because while it was horrible, obviously, personally, because of what they did to you, it brought all eyes onto Valerie Jarrett, and now that information about that woman is starting to be brought to light, and now we have deeper context around the tweet and around her role in the last administration.
Yeah, and also the Iran deal itself.
Yeah.
Nobody got to see it.
Nope.
I mean, plane loads of cash, some of which, you know, was their money, and I'm not even talking about what we owed them.
Right.
But above and beyond that, from all over the world. But the real deal to me is the money laundering through banks. That's how they do things.
Well, what's amazing is none of us Americans, you and I, we can't leave the country with $10,000 cash. We're not allowed to. We will have it taken from us at the airport if we're found to have more than $10,000 cash. And they sent something like $400 million in cash on pallets. There's nothing. When that deal happened, even if we strip away all the things that we know, if we just went on the most generic of observations, we as Americans understand you generally don't ship pallets of cash to other nations when you're doing a legitimate business deal. It just doesn't work that way, right? So I think that was one of the things, too. We can get into the detail of it, but even just the simplicity of it. And I think one of the more odd things...
Well, I always say, which royal family did that benefit? Because it only goes to the tippy top.
That's right.
The people in Iran don't even have drinking water.
No.
They turn on their faucet and the brown rust comes out.
Yep.
People are living on the streets. They beat up old women who are trying to sell beads.
Yep.
Right on the streets.
Yeah. What's amazing about that, too, is that if we go back to Iran in the early 70s, late 60s, you're talking about one of the more modern nations in the entire world with a thriving economy, an entrepreneurial spirit. Many of the Iranians that I've known just in my life and experienced are almost all entrepreneurs and are hard workers, good people, and they love Western culture. They still love and miss Iran, but they it's not what it used to be when they were growing up, many of the people I've associated with.
Well, so. Didn't we put the Shah in there and bring, we always bring the worst and most repressive fundamentalist governments to people. That's their thanks for asking for freedom.
Absolutely. That is one of the sadder, I think, things in our in world history is what's happened to Iran just over the last 40 years. And I think it's interesting to watch as this president uses his brand and his voice to give confidence to the people in Iran to rise up.
Yeah.
Right? And I think it's interesting because he goes out on a limb almost for righteous. Whatever's righteous, you're going to see President Trump standing up for, whether it's moving the embassy in Israel to Jerusalem and acknowledging it as the capital, or whether it's turning around and acknowledging Saudi Arabia and the new king and backing them in their endeavors financially, or if it's Iran and recognizing that the people in Iran are fighting for their freedom.
And also it's that to recognize that Iran is bombing the hell out of Syria and Yemen. And people don't even know that.
Well, that's what the Russian deal's about, right?
Right.
People also, that's nowhere in mainstream media are they discussing that the actual leverage with Vladimir Putin isn't necessarily America-Russia. It's Russia controlling and dialing in Iran.
Right.
And keeping people safe. And that's one of the things that just struck this week. We find out about the deal that President Trump got done with Putin was that to have Putin remove Iranian soldiers away from the border of Syria with Jordan in Israel, because that's how you kick off World War III is going into those two nations. And he got Vladimir Putin to agree to remove the troops from that border.
I think Trump is working for peace. Do
absolutely.
You?
Absolutely. Well, and that was one of the things that's so strange, Roseanne, is watching, 2 years ago, the biggest concern in the risk of nuclear war was North Korea and Russia. And as of today, North Korea, we know, has no intent of bombing us. They've stopped even working on their missiles. They're not practicing launching them over Japan anymore. And Russia, at least from what we can tell, we're softening that discussion. He invited Vladimir Putin to the White House to have further negotiations. But as of right now, we're at a lower risk of nuclear war than at any point probably in the last 40 years.
Well, I thought we were at a high risk of nuclear war when they were helping Iran get nuclear weapons.
Absolutely.
Right?
Yeah, absolutely. That's part of it. And I think that goes, it's amazing to watch that because it ties right back into Hillary Clinton and Barack Obama and even the Bushes, Bush Senior.
It all starts with Bush.
Yeah, it does. Well, that's why we know that one of the last real presidents we had was Kennedy. And Bush, who was at the CIA at the time, we know what happened to Kennedy.
And we know that Gerald Ford was the head of the Warren Commission, too, and was the only unelected installed president of the United States.
Yep.
So it's been going on for a long time. It's nothing new. No. But, it goes all the way back to PNAC, which we won't even go into, but Project for a New American Century, written by Condoleezza Rice and all these neocons.
Yeah.
This is also the overthrow of the whole neocon agenda, isn't it?
Yeah, oh yeah.
Like seeing Bill Kristol exposed, like my boyfriend said, he tweeted him, he said, "Have you ever been right?" And he was shoved down our throats by Jon Stewart, who had him on every other week for that neocon bullshit.
Yep.
Which is Trump's doing the anti-neocon thing. It's like you guys were, just living off public money.
100%.
Your neocon scam.
At the end of the day, it was fraud. And the problem with fraud is it always collapses because fraud only works when the people aren't aware of it. Once enough people are aware of fraud, it collapses. And the bigger problem is once it collapses, because it's fraud and because it's nothing but criminals involved with it, there's no honor among thieves, which is why we have Lisa Page singing like a bird and threatening to bring down the entire FBI-CIA relationship.
I love it.
Oh, that's great.
I love her.
I hope she burns it all down. I hope she talks about all of it, because this is where fraud doesn't work anymore. And this is why the mainstream media is in a panic, the deep state, whatever we're going to call them. They're all freaking out because you and I can send out tweets and educate people in seconds. It takes them 12 hours or more to control the narrative and come up with a response. And in real time, Americans and people abroad are discussing the issues.
Yeah, without their narrative imposed on it. So let's end like this. Do you think Hillary Clinton's ever going to go to jail?
Yes, absolutely.
You do?
Yes, I really do.
When?
Unless she takes her own life, but yeah, I do believe she's going to go to jail. I think that one of the executive orders that was signed in March expands who can be prosecuted under a military tribunal. It was signed to expand to include public officials. And I think that given the nature of her crimes and some of the others involved in this, they are going to face that prosecution. However, those military tribunals and that executive order does not go into effect until January 1st, 2019.
So that's why you're always saying wait till January 2019.
Just wait, because I think what's going to happen is they're slowly red-pilling the country right now to the reality of what we've been living through. And as they control that drip, it's going to lead up to, I think where the public is going to demand justice.
Well, I hope so, because I'm like, what? You can't just let this go by. This is our whole country.
Absolutely.
Propping up dictators and terrible regimes against people, which America's done for a long time to make money.
Unfortunately.
Because that's the military-industrial complex, yep. Am I right?
Yeah, absolutely. Well,
but I call it now prison, military, pharma, food, industrial complex.
Yeah, the Patriots are taking back this country, though, at every level of government, military, you name it. It's going to be coming back. I mean, it's one of the most incredible things I've seen to see the way that they're removing people who were once powerful. The fact that a guy who was the head of the Central Intelligence Agency is now limited to throwing a tantrum like John Brenden does on Twitter, like that's it, that's what you got. At this point in your life, you worked your whole life to get to the point that now you just cry on Twitter when you've got a problem. That's it.
That's true.
You know?
Well, how do you see a Trump future? How do you see inner cities and people of color in a Trump world?
I think that we're going to spend these first 4 years draining the swamp, exposing the corruption, juicing the economy. I think we're going to spend the next 4 years after that exclusively dedicated to infrastructure, trade, and reintroducing the American dream to the public.
Well, that's what I hope to.
Yeah.
And just an end to the endless manipulation and hatred. Yeah. I call it hatriotism. You know, where you just blame somebody for all your stuff, and you do nothing about the people who are living on the streets.
Right.
Like San Francisco, a Democrat-controlled city, yeah. Like Chicago and Cleveland. It's beyond a racist quagmire.
Yeah. Well, the problem is, too, that the ideas of, quote, resistance movement and progressivism are completely opposite of one another. You can't do both those things at the same time. You can't resist and progress. So it's one or the other. Either sit down at the table and have a dialogue and scream at each other and yell, but don't get up from the table. Just keep talking until you find resolution, or you're not progressing, you're resisting. They don't go together. They don't work together.
No, they don't. We were advocating today for grassroots conversations about all these issues, race, class, jobs, what's done in our name as taxpayers and citizens of this country. And it's kind of hopeful to think about a real revolution where people regain their sovereignty and expect accountability from their government.
Absolutely.
Right?
Yeah, absolutely. And sovereignty goes hand in hand with liberty. And in order for any American, doesn't matter what class of people you belong to, you've got to have that ability to think for yourself and make decisions based on how, you know,
based
what
on
you
fact
think. That's right.
And data, not emotion.
Correct.
Right.
Well, and rather than a dog whistle, you know, getting worked up and infuriated, being told, being told how to think, what to think. You've got to be able to be offended and offend other people. That's okay. It's part of the experience. It's how we're going to learn and grow.
And then you say you're sorry. Oh, I didn't realize I offended you.
Can you imagine trying to live your whole life without ever making a mistake that you're not allowed to say you're sorry for?
Well, when you say you're sorry, as I've done over and over and over with apologies galore, they don't accept it.
No.
You're the one that told me don't ever apologize to the left because then they want blood.
Because you didn't do anything wrong. This is the biggest message I would want to get across. What you said was something that some took offense to. The only apology to be stated was, I'm sorry that I made a joke that you took in a way that offended you. I'm not sorry I said something. I'm not even sorry for the joke. At least for me, this is what I would say. Simply because I know you're not racist. You know you're not racist. And therefore, to apologize for it is giving them blood in the water. And frankly, it doesn't matter anymore.
No, I just wanted to say, I apologize that you thought it was racist.
Exactly.
That's all I can say.
Exactly.
Because it wasn't. I thought she was a white woman.
I know, we both did. I did too. I didn't know until they got pissed at you. I was like, wait, how is it racist? She's white. And then apparently she's not. And so I was like, okay, well, there's that. But I just think that...
But that should have been apology enough.
It should have been. Well, and that's part of the, I think, you know, the grace of God is when someone asks for forgiveness and is contrite and sincere in that request, we extend it to them. That's how we grow.
Well, that's what decent people do.
Right.
Well, right?
Yeah. But the left can't let you off the hook because you still love your president.
That's true.
It's the problem. That's it. You are now a proxy.
I love every president, especially when our troops are in harm's way. I feel that, you know, you have to do that. And you can dissent as well, but you don't have to, you know, hope their kid gets raped and things like that.
Right.
You can dissent in an intelligent way if you don't. But, I mean, we are at war.
Yeah.
And so when you hold up the severed head of the commander-in-chief, they weren't punished.
Right.
Bill Maher wasn't punished for, you know, saying the most despicable word in the English language, the most horrible racist word. He wasn't punished.
Nope.
Calling the president's daughter a feckless C word, they weren't punished.
No.
And
Has Whoopi Goldberg been punished yet for what she said yesterday? Do you know? I haven't seen it.
I haven't seen it, but I worry for Whoopi because I do think Whoopi's a force for good, and she's a friend, and, you know, all of us get a little frustrated sometimes.
Completely.
And I just fear that she's going to be next, that they have to have somebody from that side go down to apologize for, you know.
I think they're going to protect her.
Well, they should have protected me, too.
I think that what they should have done is if they were offended and there was going to be, if it was a legitimate issue.
First, they should
about,
have called me and said, what did it. You mean?
Yeah, and then let you explain yourself.
Instead, they said, don't say anything until this deal is signed or we're going to sue you.
Correct.
And we're going to have George Soros sue you, too.
Yeah.
So I was forced into silence, and that's another reason why I'm doing this.
Right. Well, and that was the entire objective,
right? There's two rules.
You can
say despicable things about only a certain group of people and only a certain party.
Yeah, absolutely.
And that's freedom of speech now. Thank you for being here.
My pleasure. Thank you for having me.
Come again.
I absolutely will.